Our next speaker is a man I have immense respect for, because people ask me all the time, if I want to do well in the 21st century, what skills should I master? We can talk about technology all you want, but the most important skill I believe to master is that of leadership. Because right now we have more change happening in our society than any time in human history, but we have fewer quality leaders than any time in human history. And so to have a real leader, someone who's not only a four-star general, but somebody who has a heart of gold and the kind of intensity to take on the mother of all wars with Saddam, right, and manage people from so many nations is a rather unique man, a man with two purple hearts and a heart so big you can't believe it. That is General Norman Schwarzkopf, ladies and gentlemen. Enjoy, Skinny.
You all know how much pressure you put on a speaker when you give them a rousing welcome like that before they said one word. You know, the natural tendency to say, thank you very much, this concludes my remarks, just get out of here, because it doesn't get any better. You know, when these things first of all went off up here, I thought we were under a Scud attack, and then I remember they couldn't hit a damn thing with those Scuds anyhow, so it didn't make any difference. But... by the way, for those of you who do not recognize me, I am indeed Norm Schwarzkopf. Now, I say that because for some reason people think I ought to be dressed in camouflage, you know. If you're not dressed in camouflage, you're not General Schwarzkopf. It's amazing the perceptions people have of what you look like. Let me tell you an absolutely true story. We live in a little piece of heaven in Colorado, and I go out there in the summertime, and you can tell from this magnificent body before you when I'm out there, I work out every day. And my workout always ends up in the steam room. Well, summer before last, I went into the steam room. I was not wearing camouflage at the time. And there was a guy sitting in there. And this guy turned around, he looked at me, and he looked at me again, and he said, did anybody ever tell you that from a distance you look exactly like General Schwarzkopf? And I said, yeah, I've heard that a lot. I thought I'd play along with him. He said, yeah, it's only when you get up close you realize you're not General Schwarzkopf. I never told him. He still does not know to this day that it really was me. We're going to talk about leadership today. And people always say, you know, you got a lot of nerve, Schwarzkopf, talking about leadership to an audience like this. Here are thousands of people who are here because they are leaders in their business. How can you talk about leadership to a group of successful leaders? It reminds me of a very famous college football coach. They're playing the game of the year. It was homecoming. They were playing against their traditional rival. It was late in the fourth quarter, and they were ahead by 1 point. All of a sudden, disaster befell them. First-string quarterback got knocked out of the game. Didn't make any difference. They had a good, strong second-string quarterback. Ran the second-string quarterback into the game, and on the first play, he got knocked out of the game. The coach turned around, looked at his bench, and he had one quarterback left, Johnson. Now, Johnson had never played in a college football game in his life. Johnson was a freshman, never played in a college football game in his life, and not only that, but because they had two really good quarterbacks, Johnson had hardly ever been allowed to even touch the ball. But he was the only quarterback that was there. Sent him in the game. But before they sent him in the game, coach said, Johnson, come over here. I'm going to tell you exactly what to do, Johnson, and you better go into that ball game and do exactly what I tell you to do. I don't want any false heroics. I don't want you trying to make a hero out of yourself. You do exactly what you're told. Do you understand that? Johnson said, yes, sir, I understand that. He said, now look, on the first play of the ball game, when you're in there, the theory is here we got to burn up as much time as we possibly can. We're ahead by 1 point. It's late in the fourth quarter. If we can burn up enough time, we'll turn the ball over to the defense. Hopefully the defense will hold them. We can win this ball game by 1 point. You understand that, Johnson? Yes, sir, I do. He said, okay, now here's what I want you to do. On the first play, go in and hand the ball to the fullback and send him right up the middle. He will run as long as he possibly can. He will burn up all sorts of time, and then he'll get tackled, and he won't fumble the ball because he's got great hands. Do you understand that, Johnson? Johnson said, yes, sir, I do. He said, now on the second play, I want you to give the ball to the fullback again, this time sending off tackle. Once again, he will run off tackle as fast and as far as he possibly can. He'll burn up as much time as he possibly can, and he won't fumble the ball. He said, now on the third play, Johnson, you're a quarterback. You've got good, strong hands. Here's what I want you to do. Just fade back and run around in the backfield. Just run around as long as you possibly can and burn up as much time as you possibly can. And then on the next play, kick the ball to the other team, and hopefully our defense will take over and hold. You understand that, Johnson? Johnson said, yes, sir. Coach, I do understand that. He said, all right, get in there and do what I told you to do. But let me tell you one more time. By golly, you better do exactly what I tell you to do, or I will personally come out on that field. I will rip the jersey off your back in front of everybody. I will cancel your athletic scholarship, but I'll see to it you never play football any place in the entire United States of America again. Do you understand that, Johnson? Johnson says, Coach, I understand that. Johnson went in the ball game. On the first play, hands the ball to the fullback runs in the middle of the line, bam, gets stopped dead, doesn't burn up any time, absolutely stopped dead in his tracks, but he doesn't fumble the ball. Second play, Johnson gives the ball to the fullback, this time he's supposed to go off tackle, he gets tackled in the backfield, burns up no time at all. So on the third play, Johnson gets the football, and he's running around the backfield all over the place, he's being chased by these great big huge defensive linemen, breathing down his back, he's running for his life. And he looks around, and there's an opening on the right-hand side of the field, and he runs around the right-hand side of the field and runs 99 yards downfield and is tackled on the one-half-yard line of the other team. Next play, they come out, punt formation, kick the ball clear out of the stadium. Clear out of the stadium! But because Johnson has made this great run, they end up, the ball game is over, they've won by 1 point. Everybody pours out on the field, they're hugging each other and cheering and celebrating and everything like this. And the coach goes over and offers his condolences to the losing coach. And he turns around, and in the middle of the field, there stands Johnson. And he just can't help himself. He runs over there, and he gets right in Johnson's face. And he says, Johnson, what in the hell were you thinking when you kicked the ball out of the stadium? And Johnson said, I was thinking it's a damn good thing we're ahead by 1 point because we sure got a stupid coach. Now, believe it or not, there is a leadership moral to this story, okay? And it kind of goes like this. We may be successful leaders, but it's entirely possible that we're ahead by only 1 point. And it's even more possible that some members of your team may think they have a dumb coach. So there's never anything wrong with going back and talking about basic fundamental leadership, and that's what we're going to do today. Now, there's no magic formulas here today. I'm going to talk about some basic fundamental principles and techniques that have worked for me over my many, many years as a leader, and I hope that you all find something here that will work for you. Now, I've been known as the leader of 541,000 people in the Gulf War. I didn't always lead that many people. I've been involved in leadership for 40 years. My first leadership assignment was a squad of about 11 men. Then later on, a platoon of 40, a company of 150, a battalion of 600, a brigade of 2,500, a division of 18,000. All of a sudden, one day I turned around, I was in charge of 541,000 people. But you know, I found there's certain basic fundamentals that apply to any size organization. And that's what we're going to talk about today. They also apply to any type of organization. And that's important because every single one of you is a leader. Every single one of you is a leader. Many of you are leaders in your business, of course. That's why you're here. But others of you are leaders in the school system because you have children in the school system and you get involved in PTA and things like that. Others of you are leaders in community activities. Rotary, Lions Club, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts. Many, many of you are leaders in your church. And every single one of you is a leader in your home. So what we're going to talk about today are principles that apply to any leadership role you may have in mind. And I want you to kind of project yourself into the various leadership roles that you're involved in as we talk today. Now, I know what's going on out there. Somebody's saying, wait a minute, Schwarzkopf. I'm not a born leader. Joe over there is a born leader, or Susie over here is a born leader, but I'm not a born leader. Let's put that to rest right now. I don't believe there's any such thing as a born leader. I don't think the circumstances of your birth make any difference whatsoever when it comes to your ability to lead. As a matter of fact, you know, if you go back and look in the history books to the people in the history books that are known as the great leaders, you will find that they were rather ordinary people. They were ordinary people who found themselves in extraordinary circumstances, and because at that moment in history they were able to rise to the challenge, they became known as the great leaders of history. But I got to tell you, none of them became great leaders because of the circumstances of their birth. Let me see if I can give you an illustration of this. Schwarzkopf family are great dog lovers. We have two dogs. One of them's name is Orso. Orso is the Italian word for bear. Orso is imported from Germany. Orso is a German shepherd. I mean, a magnificent animal, you know, big, bushy, black and tan fur. He's got a long, bushy tail, long fangs hanging out of his mouth, pointed ears. Orso weighs 90 pounds, and I got to tell you, he is so magnificent that on last year's Purina Dog Chow calendar, Orso was Mr. May. His mommy and daddy are very proud of him. I want you to know that. We have another dog. His name is Grizz. Grizz is short for grizzly bear. Grizz is also imported from Germany. Grizz is a wire-haired dachshund. He looks like a cross between a toilet brush and a hot dog. Grizz weighs 18 pounds. Now, which of those two dogs do you think is the undisputed leader in the Schwarzkopf household? Grizz. You see, Grizz has never looked in a mirror. The only thing Grizz has ever seen is Orso. Grizz thinks he's a 90-pound German shepherd. And worse yet, Orso thinks he's an 18-pound wire-haired dachshund. It gets me in trouble every now and then. But I call this the Grizz principle of leadership. Doesn't matter to Grizz the circumstances of his birth. He thinks he's a leader. And by golly, since he thinks he's a leader, he is a leader. And that's the very first thing you should think about when you think about leadership. You have to believe that you can be a leader, because every single one of you can be. That's the Grizz principle of leadership. Okay, let's talk about leadership. What is leadership? We live in a world that's crying out for leadership. We hear it all the time. We wouldn't have had the debacle we had in Somalia if we had better leadership on the part of the UN. We wouldn't have the terrible circumstances we're having over there in the Balkans. People point to all sorts of different things happening internationally and say they wouldn't be happening if we had better leadership. We live in a country that's crying out for leadership. I guarantee you that in the next election, for whatever position you're talking about, from president to dog catcher, every single candidate will claim they have it. They will claim they have it, this thing called leadership, and of course they will insist that their opponents do not have it, this thing called leadership. What is it that describes General Georgie Patton with his pearl-handled pistols, but at the same time can describe the magnificent work of Albert Schweitzer in Africa? What is it that can describe the dedication of a Mother Teresa, but at the same time the iron will of a Margaret Thatcher, and at the same time the charisma of a Princess Diana? I will confess to you, I've been involved with leadership for over 40 years, and despite that, I still do not have a satisfactory definition of this thing called leadership. I'm sort of like the Supreme Court justice was when they asked him to define pornography. Remember what he said? He said, I don't know what it is, but I recognize it when I see it. And that's sort of where I am when it comes to this definition of a thing called leadership. But since I was preparing a lecture on leadership, I thought, well, I got to have a good definition, so I went where else? I went to the dictionary. Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary. Here it is. Now, this is really heavy. Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary. Leadership. The quality of a leader. That really isn't very helpful. I thought, there's no problem then. I'll just look up leader. Here it is. Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary. Leader. Something that leads. You get the feeling that the folks that write these dictionaries don't understand much about leadership. It went on. I thought, well, look, they have some examples of leaders in there. I like this one. Leader, short length of material attached to a fishing lure. That I can identify with, okay? I've been attached to so many fishing lures in my life, I definitely understand being a leader. But there was more. Leader, the primary shoot of a plant. Leader, member chosen by his or her party to manage party activities. Leader, the first or principal performer of a musical group. Madonna. I like this one. Leader, the principal member of the party elite in a totalitarian state endowed of official ideology with heroic or mystical character and who governs with a minimum of constitutional restraints to the extreme national demagogy. Yeah, you kind of put all that together and you come to the conclusion that a leader could be a turnip green or a politician. And given the state of affairs in Washington, D.C., that may be a somewhat redundant statement. I'm not sure. For those of you who didn't clap, that was not a political statement. That was just a joke. That's all that was. Or a leader can be a rock star or any of these other things, and I will tell you that in my 40-some-odd years of being involved with leadership, I've met leaders who were each of those, and I've met leaders who were all of them combined, and I still have not been able to come up with a satisfactory definition of this thing called leadership. Now, I know what it's not. I know what it's not. It's not managership. That was a very popular concept in the 50s and the 60s. Leadership and management are the same. I reject that. Yes, you want your managers to be leaders, if possible. But managers manage stores and systems and banks and finances and shops and clubs and computers and factories and equipment. Managers manage things. I met a lot of people who were great managers, but they were terrible leaders. They were great at financial management, or they're great at systems management or some other kind of management, but they forgot the fundamental element of their organization. People. People. Leaders lead people. People with hopes and dreams and ambitions, just like they have hopes and dreams and ambitions. But without these people, all the high technology systems and equipment and organizations that the managers manage would utterly and completely fail. Leaders lead people. I used to take brand new second lieutenants that would come into my outfit, and I'd say, look, go down to the motor pool and find the best tank in the motor pool. Stand at rigid attention in front of the tank and say, right face. Nothing happens. That tank just squats there and looks at them. I'd say, go down to the airfield, find the fanciest airplane down there. Go to the airplane and say, fly. Nothing happens. Nothing happens. It is only when you put people in that tank or that airplane that anything at all is going to happen. But it's more than that. It's only when you have other people who on a daily basis are refueling and repairing and maintaining that tank or that airplane that anything at all is going to happen. And it's more than that. It's only when you have the logisticians to the rear who are sending forward the fuel, the ammunition, the critical spare parts, that anything at all is going to happen. And it's even more than that. It's only when you go all the way back to the very factories where these two ultra-high-tech systems are manufactured. And on a daily basis, people are manufacturing the critical spare parts that are necessary to keep these type of systems operating. It's only when you have all of those people involved that these two ultra-high-tech weapon systems can do anything at all. So that's the first thing we must remember, and that's leaders lead people. That's what leadership's all about. Now, while I don't have an adequate definition of this thing called leadership, we do know some things about it. I think I know what the challenge of leadership is. You know, if I had a handful of $1,000 bills, and I said, everybody who follows me through that exit right up there, I'll give you $1,000. I dare say that even in this very sophisticated audience, some of you all up there are going to be trampled to death. But does that make me a great leader? Of course not. Because all I'm doing is asking you to do what you would do for anyone under any circumstance. That's not what the challenge of leadership is about. The challenge of leadership is something different. The challenge of leadership is to get people, there's that word again, underline it mentally, to get people to willingly, underline that word, willingly, do that which they ordinarily would not do. That's the challenge of leadership. That's why leadership is so important in the armed forces. We're doing what? We're asking young men and women to willingly do the one thing that all of us intuitively in the crib know not to do, and that's risk our very survival. And yet we're asking them to willingly do that for their country. So that's the challenge of leadership. And I'm going to come back to that a little bit later. Now, there's some other things we know. Whenever there are three or more people together, there's always a leader. Whenever there's three or more people together, there's always a leader. The interesting thing about that is that not always the person who thinks they're the leader who really is the leader. We've all been in organizations where someone thought they were in charge. Someone thought they were the leader. And then the true crisis occurs and everybody in the organization turns to someone else who is truly the charismatic leader. You're not the leader just because your title's boss. You're not the leader just because you sign a paycheck. And you're not the leader just because you have the power. So what does it take to be a leader? Well, first of all, it takes competence. Of course, it takes competence. Okay, you got to know your job to be a good leader. But I've known an awful lot of people who are very, very competent, and they were still bad leaders. So I think I've come to the conclusion after all of these many, many years that the single most important ingredient of this thing called leadership is something called character. Character. Leadership involves a sense of duty. Leadership involves ethics. Leadership involves value systems. Leadership involves integrity. And leadership indeed involves morality. I've been challenged by the cynics on that. Oh, Schwarzkopf, you make too much of this thing called character. Character isn't really important. As a matter of fact, 6 years ago, character was literally removed from the agenda of things we talked about at our presidential election because everybody decided that character was not that important. But I say to these cynics, I say, look, go back and look at the leadership failures that have occurred in this country in the last 100 years. 99%+ of all of the leadership failures that have occurred in this country in the last 100 years have not been failures in competence. They have been failures in character. Look at the scandals on Wall Street. Look at the scandals on Wall Street a few years ago. These were the most competent financial managers in the whole world. They let greed get in the way, and greed happens to be a character failure. We had a president that was swept into a second term in office because he was considered to be so competent by the American people, and then Richard Nixon was kicked out of office because he lied to the American people and got involved in criminal activity. And whether we want to mention it or not, we have to face the fact that we just had a leadership void and vacuum and failure in our own nation's capital because, once again, we had a president that lied to the American people, and that happens to be a character failure. Why is this thing called character so important in the leadership of an organization? Recently, there was a poll. There was a poll of workers. 75% of the workers polled said they lie to their bosses on a regular basis. Now, that's scary. But let me tell you what's more scary. When they were asked, why do you lie to your bosses? They said, because our bosses lie to us. And if our bosses are unethical and our bosses think they can lie to us, then it's all right for us to lie to our bosses. See, the leadership of any organization, okay, the ethical climate of any organization is established by the leadership of the organization. And that's why character is so important. When leaders are picked by peers in time of crisis, we see it over and over and over again, they are always picked for their character. Because in time of crisis, it's character that really counts. You see, leaders lead by example. And therefore, whether they like it or not, they live in glass houses. People want to look at their leaders and hope that their leaders are better human beings than they are. Now, that's obvious. That's obvious. Because they want to feel that the people that are making the critical decisions that are going to affect their lives, and therefore the lives of their families, and therefore the lives of their co-workers, and therefore the entire community, they want to feel that the person who's making that kind of decision is someone who holds himself or herself to a higher set of standards and values. There's not one person in here that wants to be led by some jerk off the street. You want to be led by somebody who's special. That's what you want. And don't misunderstand me. That doesn't mean you have to be loved to be a leader. Yeah, we all want to be loved. You bet we want to be loved, and it's great if you can be loved. But often leadership requires you to make the kind of decisions that are going to cause you not to be loved. That's not important. What is important is that you are respected. I have never met a great leader who was not respected. And they're respected because they recognize a need for action. They make things happen, and then they take responsibility. They take responsibility for their own actions, and they take responsibility for the actions of the entire organization that they choose to lead. I've had people say, yeah, General, that's right, but see, I delegate my responsibility. You can't do that. You can and you should delegate your authority. Delegate your authority to empower those people within your organization to do what you ask them to do, but you cannot delegate the responsibility. If you are the leader, the responsibility is always, always, always going to be yours. It's sort of like the great quarterbacks. You had one talk to you this morning. Think about the great quarterback. When the ball game is over, if the team wins, they give credit to the team. If the team loses, they take the blame themselves. That's sort of what this business of leadership is all about. For that reason, leadership isn't always easy. I like to say leadership is a series of emotional peaks and valleys, and if you're just lucky, you're going to have more peaks and valleys, but that isn't always the case. I mean, I can think of times when my morale was lower than a snake's belly. Higher headquarters was criticizing us for something we had done or something I had said. Things weren't coming together in the organization. Too many people being hurt on the job. We just weren't getting it all together. And my morale would be terrible. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, would come Rear Rank Rudy. You all know who Rear Rank Rudy is. Rear Rank Rudy is a soldier that has one combat boot tied one way and the other combat boot's tied a different way. One trouser leg is in the boot, the other trouser leg's out of the boot. Zipper's either half up or half down, depending upon how you want to look at it. Belt buckles over here, neckties over there. You know, it looks like your typical Naval Academy graduate, if you know what I mean, okay? I see you all have met Rear Rank Rudy, too. But anyhow, out of nowhere comes Rear Rank Rudy. He says, sir, can I talk to you for a minute? And you think the last thing in the world I want to do now is talk to Rear Rank Rudy. Say, yeah, Rudy, what is it? He says, well, a bunch of the guys and me, we were talking about you last night in the barracks. And you think, oh, boy, here it comes. Say, yeah, Rudy. He said, we were talking about you last night in the barracks. We know you care about us. We think you're doing a pretty good job. And wow! The batteries are recharged. You are ready to go back out there and take on the windmills and the dragons and whatever else you got to take on in your responsibility as a leader. Because you see, the true rewards of leadership come from leadership itself. If you are in the leadership business only for the next tangible reward, you are in trouble. You are doomed to disappointment. Let's face it. We all live in a pyramidal society, and we enter down here, and as we work up through the workforce, that pyramid gets narrower and narrower, and eventually we all get knocked off the pyramid. Somebody out there said, yeah, but I'm going to make it to the top of the pyramid. Yeah, I've seen people make it to the top of the pyramid, and then they stay there for a little while, and they try and jump to a different pyramid, and they often miss. Or worse yet, think of this now. Think of this. Can you believe that the United States Army takes brilliant, handsome, erudite general officers and retires them, for crying out loud, when they reach a certain age? I mean, can you imagine that? So eventually, we're all going to get knocked off the pyramid, no matter where you are on that pyramid. And if the only reason why you're in that leadership business is for the next tangible reward, the next promotion, the next citation, the next something or other, the next pay raise, one of these days is not going to come. And you are going to leave disappointed. But if you understand that the true rewards of leadership come from this thing called leadership itself, if you understand when that day comes and you get knocked off the pyramid, you can look back and say, gosh, we had a great team. We did good stuff together. I'm really proud of what my team did. If you can just say that the day you get knocked off the pyramid, it's going to stay with you until the end of your days and be a constant source of warmth and happiness for you, because the true rewards of leadership come from leadership itself. Now, I'm sure at this point somebody say, wait a minute, Schwarzkopf said he's going to give me something I can use in my leadership role, and so far he's just given me a sermon. So I'm now going to give you some really basic baking techniques that have worked for me, and I hope they work for you. Here's the first one. No organization will ever get better until the leadership is willing to admit that something is wrong with it. No organization will ever get better until the leadership is willing to admit that something's wrong. When I first came in the Army, we had annual training tests. Every year they'd call us out in the middle of the night and they'd run us over hill and dale, and people would be running around behind us writing little things down on clipboards. And at the end of a whole week, they'd run us into a hot, stuffy classroom, and we all fell asleep because we didn't care what was written down on that clipboard. All we cared about was the final grade. That's all we cared about, the final grade. And you know what? It was always the same. It was always the same. 98.5% was always the same grade every single year. Now, look, even to this young, untrained second lieutenant, I knew that outfit wasn't that good. I knew I was that good, of course. As a matter of fact, I was a little bit better than that, but I didn't know the rest of the outfit wasn't that good. But you know what? Because we got that grade, we never changed anything. You don't change when you're 98.5% good. So every single year, we went back and we allocated our resources to exactly what we allocated to before. Our fuel, our ammunition, our dollars. Every single year, we went out and we trained on exactly the same subjects we trained on before. And of course, we made sure we did over and over and over again those things we did well, so that when our bosses came down and looked at us, we looked really good. You don't change when you're 98.5% good. As a matter of fact, in those days, some Department of Defense organizations adopted a motto, zero defects. Now, zero defects is a great motto if you're in the business of manufacturing critical equipment that's going to be used in life-saving circumstances in a hospital emergency room or operating room. But zero defects is the stupidest motto you could ever adopt when you're dealing with people, when you're dealing with human beings. And that's what the armed forces is. It's human beings. We went to a place called Vietnam, and we discovered we had a few defects. So when Vietnam was over, those of us decided to stick around and said, we've got to change the way we're doing business. Because, see, we knew our assets were going to dry up to nothing. And believe me, after the Vietnam, we had nothing. For years, we had nothing. We said, we're going to have to start using our meager assets, you know, to fix what's broken out there, not just keep on doing the same thing over and over again. We've got to start admitting what's wrong. And everybody said, well, of course you did. That is so logical. You don't understand. Up until that time, we were a can-do army. Schwarzkopf, can your outfit do this? Can do, sir. Can your outfit do that? Can do, sir. Can you leap over the Empire State Building single bound? Can do, sir. Are you more powerful than a speeding locomotive? Can do, sir. Of course. You never said can't do. As a matter of fact, if you said can't do, they said, get rid of that bum. We don't want anybody around here who doesn't have a can-do attitude. But now, all of a sudden, we are, in fact, asking our leadership to say can't do. I expect to go out to one of my battalions while it's training, and I say, what are you doing today? They say, we're doing D. Well, why are you doing D? Well, we went to the National Training Center, and we found out we do A, B, and C really well, and we're terrible at doing D, so we're doing D. And you look at them, and they look terrible, and you're glad. And you go right next door to exactly the same kind of organization, and they're doing X, Y, Z. And you say, why are you doing X, Y, Z? I said, because we can do A through W just great, but we're terrible at X, Y, Z, and that's why we're doing X, Y, Z. And you look out there, and they look terrible, and you are glad. You're glad. I'm sure people out there say, wait a minute, this is so fundamental, this is so amateurish, why is Schwarzkopf wasting our time with this? Let me tell you something. That one single principle alone made the difference between the very mediocre forces we sent to Vietnam and the totally outstanding forces we sent to Desert Storm. That one principle alone. So no organization is ever going to get better until the leadership is willing to admit that something's wrong. Now, there's a corollary to that. If you remember, Iraq and Iran fought a war for 8 years prior to the Gulf War. Okay? Iraq is the second largest oil producer in the Gulf. If they'd applied their oil revenues to their standard of living, they'd have one of the highest standard of living in the world. But instead, Saddam Hussein had spent all of his money on war material and trying to develop weapons of mass destruction. And they, at the end of 6 years, they were flat broke. So he called in a group of his closest advisors, and he said, this is our circumstances. I want this to be a brainstorming session. Anybody has any idea how we get out of this problem, let us know. One of his very best friends stood up and said, Mr. President, you are so closely associated in the minds of the Iranians with this war, it's hard to believe we'll be able to negotiate a settlement as long as you're the president. So why don't you step aside for 6 months, and at the end, we'll negotiate a settlement, and at the end of that 6 months, we'll make you president again. Saddam Hussein took that person who was his best friend, took him outside the door, and shot him dead. Bang! Then came back in and said, okay, who else has a good idea? We laugh. But let me tell you two things about that story. Number one, it's a true story. It's a true story, which is frightening. But number two, we have all been in organizations where the leadership says to us, okay, speak up. We want to know how you really feel. Tell us what it's like out there. And the first person that says something negative, bang, we shoot the messenger. No organization will ever get better until the leadership is willing to admit that something is wrong, and you must have a climate within that organization that allows people to say that something is wrong. Okay, what's next? Goals. Leaders set goals. I'm sure somebody out there said, I understand about this goal business. General, for crying out loud, I went to all those management by objective classes that we all had to go to years ago, and I learned all about goals. I know all about goals, too. Hey, let me tell you what. When I got to Vietnam, I was a captain, landed at Tonsonute Air Force Base, and they promptly ran us into a hot Quonset hut in July because 2 days before the VC had blown up the terminal. First thing they did is they handed me a card, a little 3x5 card. And they said, okay, Captain, on this card are the 18 reasons why we're in Vietnam. And if anybody ever asks you why you're in Vietnam, you should look at this card, and this card will have the 18 reasons why you're in Vietnam. And particularly if a member of the press asks you, you know, pull this card out and look at it. I was also told that you have to carry the card in your right rear pocket at all times because at any time a senior officer can challenge you, and you must produce your card as to why you were in Vietnam. Think how stupid that is. Okay, 2 weeks later, I'm laying face down a rice paddy. Machine gun bullets are screaming over my head. I don't know if I'm going to be alive 15 minutes from now. Am I supposed to pull out my card and find out what the hell I'm doing here? I mean, think about that. But you know what? That's the way some organizations establish their goals. That's the way some organizations establish their goals. Goals are only meaningful if, number one, everyone in your organization understands the goals. But far more importantly, number two, everybody in your organization could clearly understand the role they will play in accomplishing that goal. People ask me all the time, how'd you hold a coalition together? I mean, you know, 800,000 people, cross-national, cross-religious, cross-cultural, how in the world did you ever hold them together? I say it was simple. We had one goal. One goal. And everybody in the organization, from the highest ranking general down to the lowest ranking private in the foxhole, clearly understood we had one goal, and they understood what that goal was. And they understood what their role was going to be in accomplishing that goal. Kick Iraq out of Kuwait. Period. That was the one goal, and we all knew it. And that's what kept us together. That's what kept us focused. Leaders focused their organization by establishing goals. And every now and then, somebody would come in with their hair on fire. Oh, my goodness, we got this cultural problem. We got to solve this problem. The Arabs think this way, and we think that way. And we got to get the Arabs aside and teach them that we're right, which was pretty presumptuous, come to think of it, since at that time our culture was 214 years old, and theirs was 5,000 years old. But anyhow, I'd say, wait a minute. Why? Why do we have to do that? Oh, well, you know, gee, if we don't do that down the line, you know, we're going to have problems, and there's going to become a cultural clash out here if we don't, you know, make them understand the right way to do this. I said, look, we don't need to do that now. Stay focused on the goal. That's what leaders use their goals for. They keep their organization focused on what's important. Now, think about what I just said. Goals not only tell your organization what it is you want them to do, it tells your organization that they don't have to do anything else. They don't have to do anything else. Sure, later on you can change your goals to something else, and then they will do something else. But the important thing about goals is leaders should use goals to focus their organization on what they're doing now and to relieve their organization of the requirement to do anything else and not waste their time and their talent. Leaders focus their organization with goals. Okay, what's next? Standards. You show me a high-performing organization, I'll show you an organization where the leadership has established high standards and demands them. You show me a low-performing organization, I will show you one where the leadership accepts low standards. I came home one day from high school. My dad met me at the door, and he said, son, how'd you do on that math test you had today? I said, Dad, I did just great. I got an 80. It was the highest grade in the class. My father looked me straight in the eye and said, do you know that that means you don't know 20% of everything you're supposed to know about that subject? I thought that was really stupid. My son came home from college recently. And I said, son, how'd you do in that finance course you were really worried about? He said, Dad, I did great. I got an 85 on my final. And I said, did you know? And he thinks I'm stupid too, okay? He thinks I'm stupid. But it's this thing about establishing standards. This thing about establishing standards. Why is that important? I want you to imagine a brand new sitcom of a young married couple, newlyweds. Get up in the morning, they get dressed, they have breakfast, hopefully in that order. And then the breadwinner goes to the door, and she turns to her spouse and says, why is it I only hear female voices out there? But anyhow, the breadwinner turns to the spouse and says, I'm going off to my very first job where I'm excited, I'm looking forward to failing. What? Tilt? Wrong. Wrong. Nobody goes to work to fail. 100% of all the people who go to work to succeed. People work to succeed. Whether it's a CEO all the way down to the clerk in the mailroom, everybody goes to work to succeed. But how do they know when they succeeded? That's where standards come in. Standards are the measure of success. Standards tell people what is expected of them, and then they will do what? They'll do better than that. Think of the last time you were in an academic classroom. You walked into the classroom for the first time. What's the first thing you said? What's it take to pass this course? Do they grade on the curve here? Sure. And as soon as you got an answer to that, what were you going to do? You're going to do better than that. You're going to do better than that. So standards are the measure of success within an organization. And when your standards have been applied, then you are going to do better than that. And why is that important? Remember the fundamental challenge of leadership, to get people to willingly do that which they ordinarily would not do. That's standards. You establish standards for your organization, and your people will willingly try and do better. We know there's vast untapped potential in our workforces out there today. How do you get more out of your people? You set high standards. Now, don't get me wrong. You set your standards 100%, you're not going to get 100%, but you may get 95. But you establish your standards at 70. Let me tell you what you're going to get. You're going to get 70. Standards are so, so important. Next point. If I haven't learned anything else about people, I've learned this. Failure is contagious, but success is infectious. Failure is contagious, but success is infectious. I've seen organizations that failed so often that finally they undertake every challenge that they're going to ever have to face with the expectation of failure, and guess what? They fail every single time. And then I've seen new leadership introduced into the organization. The new leader would give them something they couldn't fail at. And when they did not fail out, when they succeeded, the leader would stand up in front of them and say, oh, wow, look what you've done. I'm proud of you. And go around and slap a few people on the back and shake a few hands. And then give them another task that they couldn't fail at. And when they succeeded that, he'd go back out and he'd stand in front of them and say, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of being your leader. You're a bunch of winners. And then give them another task that they couldn't fail at. When they succeeded at that, go around, hug a few people. It's okay to hug somebody. Hug a few people and slap a few people on the back and hand out a few promotions and hand out a few pay raises. And you know what? Because this thing called success is infectious, before long, that same organization that undertook every task with the expectation of failing now undertakes every task with the expectation of success. Because success is infectious. Leaders reinforce success within their organizations. Now, you also got to be willing to accept a few mistakes. Oh, wait a minute, Schwarzkopf. I was with you up to that point. What's this mistakes business, okay? Listen, I don't believe in freedom to fail. I believe what Vince Lombardi said, show me a good loser, I'll show you a loser. But oh, by the way, don't raise your hands in response to this question, but just answer this question mentally. How many people in this room learned something about your current job by screwing it up the first time? Yeah. Okay, so I'm not talking about freedom to fail. I'm talking about establish within your organization a latitude to learn for your people. Okay, one last point. Great leaders don't tell people how to do their job. Don't get me wrong, they tell them what to do. They allocate resources, they establish standards, they establish timelines, they talk about expectations, all of that. But great leaders don't tell people how to do their job. First of all, they clearly understand they don't know how to do every job better than everybody else in their organization. That's why they got all these other people. But I think the other thing is they understand that old geometry theorem, you know, the whole is the sum of the parts. They understand that if you take people and give them resources and let them use their initiative to go out and do what they do best, if that's happening throughout your entire organization, when all of these pieces come together, I call it the synergy of human initiative, when all the pieces come together, the result is going to exceed anything you ever dreamed of because of this wonderful thing called human initiative. So great leaders don't tell people how to do their job. They tell them what to do, and then they empower them to do it. Okay, you put all that together, and it summarizes as follows. Admit what's wrong, set goals, establish high standards, reward success, have a latitude to learn within your organization's power down, and now forget everything I told you. Just forget it all, because you don't need to remember any of that. I am now going to give you the two secrets to 21st century leadership, and all you've got to do is remember and apply these two secrets, and I promise you that each and every one of you will be a great leader in the 21st century. I was promoted to two-star general. That was the good news. The bad news was I was sent back to Washington, D.C. for the fifth time. Washington, D.C., the only place you can run 10 miles in a straight line and still be at the scene of the crime. You know, the home of the world's two largest adult daycare centers, the Pentagon and the Congress, okay? And I was sent back there. The Congress doesn't like it when I say that, you know that. And I don't care, you know that. That's but anyhow, I was sent back, and I was the number two man in charge of personnel for the entire United States Army, at that time about 4 million people. I'd been on the job for exactly 1 week. I came in one morning. My boss comes walking out the door. He's got two suitcases in his hand. He says, Norma, I'm heading out for Europe. I'm going to visit the troops for a couple of weeks in Europe. Then I'm going to go through the Middle East, and I'm going to go to the Far East. I'll be back in about a month. And he heads out the door and heads down the hall of the Pentagon. I absolutely panicked. I ran after him. I said, wait a minute. I've been here 1 week. What am I supposed to do? What do I do if the chief of staff of the Army called me, or the secretary of the Army, or the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, or some dumb politician called me? What am I supposed to do? He turned around. He looked me straight in the eye, and he said, Rule 13. I said, yes, sir, Rule 13. Do you mind telling me what Rule 13 is? And he said, sure, Rule 13. When placed in command, take charge. When placed in command, take charge. That same boss I saw one time get a briefing in his office on a very complicated subject, and I know he didn't understand one word of that briefing because I didn't understand one word of that briefing. I was a hell of a lot smarter than he was, but I never told him that because he was a hell of a lot higher ranking than I was. But anyhow, to my amazement, he ends up making a decision at the end of the briefing and causing that decision to be implemented throughout the entire United States Army. So when everybody left the room, I went over to him. I said, sir, in all due respect, I know you didn't understand anything in that briefing, and I know you didn't know anything about that subject. How in the world could you possibly have made a decision? He said, Schwarzkopf, I may have just made the wrong decision. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. He said, don't you understand that problem has been in the Pentagon for 7 straight years. For 7 straight years, no one has understood it well enough to make a decision. He said, I may have made the wrong decision. It doesn't make any difference. We've moved that problem out into this great force of ours where there are thousands of talented people who will take my bad decision and turn it into a good decision, and we'll be well on our way to solving that problem. But if I hadn't made a decision today, if I hadn't made a decision, We would still be facing that problem 1 year from now. At that time, we would have been in the Pentagon for 8 years, and we'd be no further along in the solution than we are today. Rule 13, when placed in command, take charge. Take charge. Remember what I told you about great leaders? Great leaders are respected because they grab responsibility. They make things happen. They recognize a need to make it happen, and they make things happen, and then they take responsibility for it. Rule 13. I said, okay, I got it. Boy, am I going to take charge. So he picked up his bags and he started heading down the hall of the Pentagon, but I kind of tripped along behind him and said, but do you mind giving me a little guidance? What do I do about the recruiting system, and what do I do about the enlistment system? What do I do about the re-enlistment system? What do I do about the promotion system? What do I do about... And he turned around and he said, Rule 14. And I said, yes, sir. He said, Rule 14. Schwarzkopf, do what's right. Do what's right. Notice he didn't say to me, do what you think the chief of staff of the army would tell you to do. He didn't even say to me, do what you think I'd want you to do. He certainly didn't say, do what makes you look good. Okay? He didn't say any of that. He said, do what's right. And you see, we're right back to this character thing again. Because you know what? When really, really tough decisions have to be made, in the deep dark of night, when no one is there to grade your paper, when no one is there to place blame, when you know what the popular decision would be, you know what would make you maybe look good, but not the right thing to do, that's when this thing called character really comes into play. Because that's when you got to be ready to do what's right. And those are the two secrets to 21st century leadership. That brings us full circle because it brings us back to the end of the Gulf War. One of my division commanders said, Barry McCaffrey, who's now head of the drug program, he said, you know, if we had had their equipment, they'd had ours, we still would have won. We would have won because we knew our cause was just. How did we know our cause was just? Because before we kicked off the ground campaign, we were receiving 400 tons of mail every single day. 400 tons of mail saying that our cause was just, that we were doing the right thing. So when our troops were committed to battle, they knew they were doing the right thing. What I hear more than anything else since I've been back in the States is people come up to me and say, thank you, General Schwarzkopf, for restoring my faith in my country and my military. I say, wait a minute. Wasn't General Schwarzkopf that restored your faith in your country? It was 541,000 magnificent American men and women who were jerked. They were jerked from the breast of their family on short notice and sent halfway around the world to the most inhospitable environment you could ever imagine. They had to face the heat and the insects of the desert during the day and the cold and the damp of the desert at night. They had to go to bed dreaming dreams that nobody ever would have to dream. They had to think about death. They had to face death. And some of them, in fact, gave their lives. That's who restored your faith in your country. And you should never, ever forget that. But did you ever ask yourself, why did they do it? Why did they do it? The answer is very simple. They did it because their country asked them to, and therefore they thought it was the right thing to do. Rule 14. I got to tell you what. What I really want to ask them, though, is this. Why in the world did you ever lose faith in your country? Why did you ever lose faith in the United States of America? You know, I have been very lucky. I have lived and traveled all over the world all of my life, and I've traveled and lived extensively in 48 different countries. I want you to know, with all of our faults and all of our problems, the United States of America is still the greatest nation on the face of this earth, bar none. You know, our friends tell us that willingly, our enemies tell us that grudgingly, and our former enemies are doing what? They're all trying to be like us. And yet we still have people in our own country that constantly tell us how terrible we are. We still have people who tell us what a lousy country we are, and they put us down. I want to tell you something. I don't understand that at all. My last day in Saudi Arabia, my counterpart said something I'll never forget. He said, you know, thank God. He said, if the world is only going to have one superpower, thank God it's the United States of America. Stop and think about that. Think about in our lifetimes the countries that could have been the world's only superpower. Hitler's Germany, Tojo's Japan, Stalin's Russia, Mao's China, any one of them with just a slight quirk in scientific discovery could have been the world's only remaining superpower. And imagine the darkness that would have descended across this earth if that had happened. But they aren't, and we are. That places an awesome responsibility on our shoulder. It places an awesome responsibility vis-a-vis our role, the rest of the world, but it also places an awesome responsibility on our shoulders as to what kind of a nation we are going to be ourselves. And once again, the naysayers and the doomsday prophets climb out from under their flat rock. They say, oh man, the United States, they can't handle it. The United States is soft. The people of the United States aren't tough enough. They point to scandal in the White House. They point to gridlock in Washington, D.C. They point to crime in Miami. They point to riots in L.A. And they say, this is what America is. I don't believe that for one second. I don't believe that for one second. I have great faith in the American people. America is the American people. You are America. You are America. We may be the world's only remaining superpower, so be it. All we got to do is remember two things, Rule 13 and Rule 14. By golly, when placed in command, we need to take charge, and above all else, we need to do what's right, and none of us will ever, ever again lose faith in this great nation called the United States of America. Thank you very much. Thank you.